That's all they want. So that's the lowest category, he says, those who just follow their senses. In fact, to move from kama to artha, one needs some discipline. If you want to succeed in life, if you want to get a degree, then you want to get a job and hold a job and move ahead in your career, in your business, a lot of effort and a lot of sacrifice is necessary. A lot of hard work is necessary. So that artha and kama together, most people you will see, this is what we want. Now, he says, religion does not have much to say to such people. Because they say all we want is pleasure and the wherewithal, the money and the wealth to get that pleasure. That's all we want. Then what is the way out for such people? God is gracious. Those who have got a conscience, for them religion starts. For those who do not have a conscience, I just want whatever I can get right now. Well, for them also God has made an arrangement. It is called the law of karma. When we do dharma, the result is punya and the result is sukha. When we do adharma, the result is papa and the result of that is dukkha. So by suffering, such people learn by suffering. That this kind of lifestyle is not sustainable. And people learn. We see it all the time. Those who are too much addicted to pleasure seeking or just money, money, money. Very soon they say this kind of life is not sustainable. There's something more in life. So then they come back to morality, decency and religion. Somebody said that this concept of antaryami, God is a conscience within. And God controls from within. There's a small voice which tells us this is right, do it. This is wrong, don't do it. Sometimes we listen to it, sometimes we do not listen to it. Now if you don't listen to it, well, God has made an arrangement external. We do not normally hear the term Bahiryami. Yami means controller. So external controller, we don't hear the term. Basically, God operates through, he says, Kala Danda, the rod of time. We learn through harsh experiences. Externally, kicks and blows. If a person does not listen to the voice inside, God will teach from external. Just like parents. If the child follows the rules of the house, very good. Parents are loving. Parents scold and may punish a child not out of anger, out of the same love if the child is not autonomously disciplined. So parents will impose an external discipline. God does the same thing. So dharma starts when we accept that religion, morality, decency, they all contribute to our happiness. They are not limiting our happiness. That's why in India, you will see the first thing they say is dharma. Not that dharma is lower than kama or artha. But dharma should be the basis of kama and artha. Basically, what does dharma do? Dharma puts a circle, a Lakshman Rekha, around our activities. This is what you will do, this is what you will not do. This is what you can say, this is what you should not say. This is what you think and this is what you should not think. If you want happiness, if you want peace of mind. So it starts with that. Nishchal Das has this classification. Only pleasure, kama, and only money, artha, he calls it pama, instinctive life. But if you accept dharma, on the basis of that, if somebody seeks pleasure in life and wealth and success in life, such a person he calls a dharmika vishayi. Vishayi, worldly person, but dharmika vishayi. Dharmika vishayi is a moral, decent, good person who wants worldly success, worldly pleasure and all that. And mostly people are like this. Mostly people are not palmer. Otherwise society would break down. In society, most people you see around you are, they want worldly pleasure. They want worldly success. But definitely they would like to think of themselves as decent people, good people, moral people. So dharmika vishayi. Now, in that article, essay on Hinduism, Houston Smith says, a time comes after you have enjoyed many things in life, after you have got some measure of success in life, after you have done something for others also. After that, another time comes. You see, even this moving out from the smaller self to a larger self, which dharma does for us. You see, everything in life teaches us to move ahead. Even, say, marriage, for example. Before marriage, a person is thinking about himself or herself. The moment you get married, you have to think about one more person. The moment you have children, you have to think of some more persons. You are expanding. In fact, most married people, their lives are for their children mostly. You will see, most of the time. You are not chasing karma. What you are doing is artha, you are earning, and mostly time is spent for family and for the people around you. So you are expanding. Naturally, human life, if you follow a moral human life, teaches you to expand. Just as an aside, modern society, there's some limitations to it. What our modern world tells us is that you'll be happy if you chase pleasure, if you earn a lot of money, you'll be happy. I've seen so many people, you know, at around our age, 40s, in the, around that time, some of my friends who were brilliant students, then they got into multinational jobs, they got married and had children. Some such people, they come and ask, Swamiji, now we see that more or less our life has taken on a pattern, and we see this is what is going to happen in our lives. Now we are fixed into a particular path of life, marriage, children, and until these children grow up, we see this is what we have to do next 20, 30, 40 years. What will give satisfaction now? Modern world, if you look at the advertisements, says you'll be happy if you buy this, you know what, iPhone 6 or something. People are, you can see the advertisement, they have got it and they are smiling, so they are happy. And that's the subliminal message coming to us, that this gadget you do, you'll be happy. If you're not happy anymore, what is the solution given by the modern world? Well, the next iPhone will come along, you'll be happier. Or you go for this vacation, if you have already been there, done that. So you need to do something more, a variation on that. There seems to be no other answer. If you are not happy with artha and karma, the only answer provided by modern society is more artha and more karma, the different variety of artha and karma. But the insight which our sages had is very interesting. At a certain stage in life, certain maturity when it comes to life, then you need to move beyond artha and karma into dharma. So when such people come, I say, simple solution. Instead of chasing down the same path and trying to repeat, you see, if you keep on repeating something and expect a different result, that's the definition of insanity. Same thing I'm doing, at one time it gave me happiness, and now it is not giving me happiness. I keep repeating it, you'll still not get happiness. You're doing the same thing, you'll get the same result. It's called cause and effect, law of causation. Now, what you need to do is something different. Now try doing something for others. Any social cause where you can help somebody who needs your help, you will see it gives you satisfaction. You see, this is the interesting paradox. We work for our own happiness, we are unhappy. You work for the happiness of others, you will be happy. It seems counterintuitive. If I give my time, energy, money and all for others, they may be happy, but how will I be happy? It works, you see. You do that for others, you will be happy. So that expansion, dharma, expansion from artha and karma into dharma. But as I said, at that point also, after doing that, the question arises, is this all in life? Houston Smith says, after even Beethoven, Mozart and Bach and the highest products of culture, the Western culture is, after this also the human person asks, is this all in life? Very soon I'll become old and die. Finished. Is this all? Well, our Shastras, they say at this point, it's like you go to a shop and show me. They don't do it here in supermarkets here, but in India, if you go to, say, clothes shops, so the shopkeeper will roll out these clothes in front of you, cloth in front of you. And if you say, nahi, I don't like this. If you buy it and go, it's okay, all right. If you say, nahi, aur kuch hai dikhai. If you have got some other kind of material, show it to me. Any special thing you have got? If you keep on persisting, the shopkeeper will say, okay, you come to the back of the shop. I have got only very choice thing which I will give you. But generally we don't show it until people ask for it. Similarly, the Vedas, our Shastras say, if you are not satisfied with dharma artha kama, beyond pleasure, engagement and meaning, if you ask for something, beyond that, then come, we have got something. The Vedas are divided into roughly Karma Kanda and Jnana Kanda. Karma Kanda is when we want certain means to get certain ends. We want to do this, we want pleasure, we want engagement, we want meaning, we want kama, artha, dharma, this is what we want. Karma Kanda tells us what to do. Beyond that, if you want to go, then it says there is something called Jnana Kanda. There is something beyond this. Beyond this mundane human life which we see. What is that? You see, the essential, the core idea of spirituality, the core idea of the Upanishads is expressed so beautifully in this mantra. Shrinvantu Vishve Amritasya Putra Aye Dhamani Divyani Tastu Vedaham Purusham Mahantam Aditya Varnam Tamasah Parastat Tameva Viditva Ati Mrityumeti Nanyah Pantha Vidyate Ayanaya. This Upanishadic mantra, it expresses the core of idea of spirituality so well. Swami Vivekananda, when he came to this country more than 100 years ago in Chicago Parliament of Religions, after that he toured this country in the United States. In many places when he gave talks, he would chant this in Sanskrit and then translate into English. What does it mean? The core idea of spirituality, the core idea of the Upanishads, and I would say the core idea of any religion, the essential idea. Listen ye children of immortal bliss, Amritasya Putra, children of immortal bliss. You see, the one fact that we all know about ourselves is that we shall die one day. We turn our face away from it. We turn our face away from it. We neglect this idea, but we know everybody dies. Vivekananda says so powerfully, kings die and beggars die.